from the high desert of Southern California and on the web at praiseyahuwah.com, announcing the kingdom of Yahuwah. And now it's time for truth with your servant host, Denya Cajaliero.
Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom, everybody. Good morning in the almighty loving name that is Yahuwah. Thank you for being here this morning, praising Yahuwah with us today. We declare his name loud and far and wide as much as we can as his people. We love you, Yahuwah, and we just are grateful to be your people. Let us Shema in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 3 through 6. Shema means to hear. Shema, therefore, Yisrael, and observe to do it that it may be well with you, that you may increase mightily as Yahuwah, almighty loving Yah of all creation of your fathers, has promised to you, to a land that is flowing with milk and with honey. Hear, O Yisrael, Yahuwah is your almighty loving Yah of all creation. Yahuwah is your only almighty one. You shall love Yahuwah, almighty loving Yah of all creation, with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your resources. These covenant words, which I restore to you this day, shall forever be on your heart. Our response is that we hear you, our great Yahuwah. Yahuwah, you are our almighty loving Yah of all creation. Yahuwah, you are our only almighty one. We pledged to love you, great Yahuwah, almighty loving Yah of all creation, with all our heart, with all our mind, and with all our resources. These covenant words which you have given us this day shall always be on our heart. Why are they on our heart? Because, friends, the most important scripture for you to study and to learn from and to repent in and to declare and to teach from is his covenant word, which is the Ten Commandments and the double commandment of love and the new commandment. Those scriptures are crucial to the worship and the teachings of someone who loves Yahuwah. Anyone who is a Yahuwahan, anyone who declares the name of Yahuwah, needs to know the covenant. We want to learn to come to know it by heart. And so if you need a copy of this covenant, we encourage you to email us at praiseyahuwah@yahuwah.com. We will send you via email the covenant truths. It's very basic, very straightforward, very clear, and it is the foundation of our hope. And every Shabbat, you want to reflect upon his covenant. How can we repent from doing wrongdoing if we do not know what it is that we're doing wrong? The covenant leads us in that direction, clearly. Welcome, friends. Welcome, all of you from around this world. I want to say a special shout out to a couple of folks that have emailed us. So many of you have, and I thank you all. Paulette Clausen, we want to thank you and appreciate you very much and your interest. Also, want to thank Brother Romaldo Liverwood from Trinidad, and he's listening in as he does faithfully. We love you, brother, and thank you for all your love. True love that I feel from your contact and communication with us, such brotherly love, and it just builds us up. Dee and I are energized when we hear from you. We thank you. Brother Dr. Yante from the Philippines, we're so thankful for your love as well. We're so glad that you found us too, and we appreciate you. And there's many more, but we've had an incredible influx. Everything is pretty much doubled. The amount of people who are coming to Yahuwah that have already perhaps even known the name of Yahuwah, but have been looking for fellowship and association. And this program right now as a broadcast, and it is a teaching broadcast for Shabbat. But we pray that it will expand to other broadcasts that will allow for greater communication, call in, and so forth. And it is not yet time, but the day is coming. And so stay tuned for that. And when that day is right, Yahuwah will make it known to us as he does everything in his own time, in his own way. Now, a few things that we'll be talking about today. First of all, we want to let you know that we're going to, towards the end of this broadcast, we will be discussing Daniel chapter 7. Now, Daniel chapter 7 is a vision or a dream and vision that Daniel had when he was living during the reign of Belshazzar. This is the king that was after Nebuchadnezzar. It can be a little confusing, so we've got some information to kind of share as we read that chapter, and it will help us to kind of understand what it is that Daniel from Yahuwah is giving to you and I, especially today. We're also going to be talking about this morning the importance of looking for good and doing good. And this will be scripture-based, as it always is, with some really encouraging and heartwarming and uplifting stories, and also some eye-opening parable stories here for you to partake in here this morning. So as we go behind the veil, we ask that you would also pray in your personal prayer for Yahuwah's Ruach to please be upon us this morning in our broadcast. As you look around, as you read on the internet certain articles, as you listen to the news, just the overall activity and thinking of those around you, your friends, coworkers, neighbors, we're finding that things are quickening in this world. We're seeing that there's a sense of urgency, that things are changing and not necessarily for the good of mankind. Fear is being created. Fear is being taught. Fear is keeping people caught in the headlights of life, like an animal with a car coming directly at it with its lights on, just stuck there in the road. Unmovable, almost hypnotized by the fear that's being created. The father of fear is Shaitan. We have to recognize that. We have to seek to find other things that can help replace the negativity that is fear. Negativity is like a cancer. And so we want to be positive. We want to understand what's going on around us. But we want to dwell on the positive love of Yahuwah. And so we don't keep our heads buried in the sand about things that are happening around us. Quite the contrary. The scriptures tell us that we're to be on the watch. We're to be aware. We're to test all things. But at the end of the day, we cling to the positive aspect of Yahuwah's word. Our walk must be positive. So the title of today's discussion this morning is Look for the Good and Do Good. So it's one thing to look for the good, but then we also must pay it forward. This is where the blessings come in. It's a blessing in itself to stay positive and to look for good things rather than to seek out only the negative things. We have to have 10 times, 100 times more good things happening that we're seeking in than the negative things. Do not let the scale, the balance of negativity, overcome the positive energy that is there for you to absorb by Yahuwah and His Word and the goodness of life, His creations. So, how do we do good? Well, a smile, a simple smile, it opens doors, does it not? It creates positive energy. When you see someone, when you go somewhere, whether it's to the supermarket or whether it's to the mall or if you're going to a pet store or wherever it is that you're at, working in your yard, your secular work, whatever it is you're doing, are you smiling? When you fellowship with other people who praise Yahuwah, or when you're fellowshipping with other people that you're trying to bring the name of Yahuwah to, are you doing it with real, true love, smiles that are positive, that are real? It seems nowadays that very few people take the time to take interest in other people. In the news and online, there seems to be nothing but negativity. The government's shutting down. There's some sort of new forced system of thing that's being thrust upon the people that the government created against their will. Or there's this meteor coming towards Earth. Or there's that type of natural or man-made disaster that's about to happen. How do we look for the good? By doing good. You know, my wife Dia, she oftentimes mentions that when she goes to the market, people seem to just kind of go up to her as though she's a friend or relative to make conversation. She remarks that she doesn't understand why they do this. It's like she's a magnet. I know why they do this. It's the reason why I've always loved her. She has this heart of energy that just surrounds her. It's attractive. The way that you are inside makes you so attractive to others, not simply an exterior shell. There's many quote-unquote good-looking people in this world, but their hearts are very rotten. They're very unattractive because they don't smile. They don't seem to have a positive glow. Well, when you smile at others and it's a genuine smile, not a fake type of forced thing, but something that's real and from your heart. When you smile, others will smile back at you. Isn't that amazing? Give it a try. When you're joyful, others become joyful around you. They're not so insecure about their own feelings. They see this person that's open and joyful, and they themselves allow that wall to come down just a little bit. When you're open to good, good will also be open to you. It will come back to you. It's as simple as that. Now, you can't define the scientific reason for this, but it's an energy of your personal ruach, your spirit that you have. Yes, you have your own ruach. That is your spirit. Some would call it your soul. And others gravitate towards that. Our master, when he was here on earth, people gravitated to him because they wanted to be near him. They sensed the goodness that he was, for he was good. Good always attracts good, positive things. Bad always attracts bad and negativity. It's like the law of gravity. It's so real, yet it requires a heart of faith to believe. Do you believe? Say, yes, I believe. I have faith. And that faith that you have, that's the faith that allows you to know things that others just can't know. It doesn't matter how many pieces of paper they have in frames on their wall that state that they graduated here or they understand and know this or that or the other. If they don't know Yahuwah and the love of Yahuwah, if they don't have a heart of faith to believe how important it is to be loving and positive, then they have nothing. They're empty vessels. When you have an empty vessel, the scriptures say to be careful that it isn't filled by bad things. And so that's why we keep our vessel stuffed full of Yahuwah's truths. You know, as an example, speaking about Dia, my wife, she was at the store recently, and a person was trying to grab a piece of produce in the produce area, and this person was in one of those electric chairs. She was elderly and a little heavy set, and you could tell, Dia said, that she just was having a hard time of it. Dia simply smiled at her. She pulled the item from the produce stand, and the woman responded immediately to her smile. Her husband was kind of standing in the distance there as she smiled at Dee. And she began to tell Dee that she was embarrassed because she doesn't normally ride in these electric carts, and this whole thing was kind of new to her, and she didn't like it. She felt immobilized, and she knew it wasn't good for her. But she was in a lot of pain, because she'd gone to doctors for medication and things for her ailments, and also there were expenses and things. And she just began to kind of bare her heart to Dia a little bit. So Dia began to kind of tell her about a website that she could go to that had discount items for her, and also to write down some things that she felt would be nutritional and so forth. And she wrote some other things down as well, as one of Yahuwah's people. But this woman did something that people don't normally do, as Dia was taking the time to talk with her. She reached out and she touched her on her arm with so much warmth and love. You know, goodness was in the air all around them. Just the conversation was lifting the heart of this woman in this chair, this mobility chair. And when the conversation had ended, the lady began to tell Dia, you know, thank you. Thank you for taking the time to talk with me and for being so nice to me today. You made my day. You know, Dia thought in her mind that this was not any sort of great, you know, deed that she did or anything, but she realized at that moment how important it is that we look for the good and that we do good. This is why people are so attracted to her. And I'm sure that you have an example of this yourself. It's magnetic, positive energy and goodness. I want to talk to you, tell you a little story. And in this story, don't know where it's from. I don't know how true it is or isn't. But it's a parable or a story that we can learn from. And let's just call this man Bob Smith. He's a pastor, as the story begins. And he was about to enter a church that was huge, just thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people. You've seen these big, huge, corporate, conglomerate, non-denominational type churches, right? Here in the high desert, where I'm from, in Southern California, there's one up here with about 10,000 people. And a good friend of mine and business associate actually attends that. And I've actually gone there a few times years past with him. And it's huge, all these people. And so this pastor, Bob Smith, he's about to go to this church for the first time. He's going to be the church's main pastor. The other pastor had stepped down to go to a smaller, more intimate church. He wanted to kind of break it down to a less corporate level. And I understand that. I personally disagree with churches and synagogues and temples and these places being ultra huge because it's impossible for the people there to get the attention that they need from those who are helping to shepherd the flock. So I'm not a big fan of churches anyway, myself, although I do believe it's important for people to not forsake the gathering of themselves together. And we seek to do that here. Your energy, your ruach is felt. We all feel it. Everyone listening can sense all those who are also listening this morning. And so we come together because it's important. Well, this pastor had gotten in touch with this other pastor who was leaving. And the pastor who was leaving was explaining to him the issues with that current congregation, why he was leaving, what he had on his plate now as the new pastor. And so Pastor Bob knew that he had a lot of work ahead of him. Well, he went to, on this particular first day, he went to this church that he was going to be the pastor of, and he went there, and he dressed up as a homeless man. He wore the clothes that looked soiled. He purposely soiled the clothes. He wore a fake beard, and his hair, he made it kind of greasy and disheveled. He made himself to really look like a homeless man. And he went into this 10,000 member church and walked around for a half an hour or so and was walking through all the people. Out of all the people in that entire time that he walked through, do you know there were only 3 people out of 10,000 people? And everybody was there that day because this was the new pastor. Everybody wanted to put their best foot forward. They were excited about the new pastor coming, new things they would learn. But as he walked around and nobody knew that this was the pastor, only 3 people stopped to say hello. Well, he went around also and was asking people for help, a little money, so he could buy a little food or get a little clothes. He then realized that that was accomplishing nothing. Not one person in the church gave him a dime. So he went and he went and sat down as the session was about to begin. Now, the elders of that particular church, some of them, the one that introduced him, knew that this pastor was not going to be in touch with those elders before the church session, that he had set it up to let this one know that you won't see me until you introduce me to the congregation. So he went, this pastor went and sat down, this homeless-looking pastor, in the front of the church. And as he sat down in this area of the church that was considered the best place to sit, the ushers of that church told him if he would sit in the back. Well, it's amazing. He said that as he all these things were occurring with him, that people that he greeted would greet him back with stares and with dirty looks, and they looked down on him, and they were kind of judging him. And their new pastor was coming today, and they really wanted their church to shine. They didn't want some homeless guy coming in and spoiling the situation in their minds. So he went ahead. He did as the usher said. He went to the back of the church. So he listened to the announcements that were happening at that church. Now, when all the announcements were done, the elder went up with the other elders behind him, and they were really excited to introduce this new pastor that they would have, because it's not every day you get a new pastor. Sometimes it's years and years you have the same pastor. So everybody was excited. Everybody, as they introduced the pastor, They said, "We'd like to introduce to you Pastor Bob Smith." Well, the congregation all got up. They were clapping. They were joyful. They were anticipatory. They were excited. The homeless man, he got up from the back of this crowd, and he started walking down the aisle. And the clapping started to stop as all eyes were on him as he started walking towards the stage. He walked up to the stage. The one elder told the other elders, "Don't worry, it's okay." He took the altar. The microphone was at there. And he stood before it. He paused for a moment. He looked around. You could hear a pin drop. Jaws were literally dropped. He said, "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance. The kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. And I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. And I was a stranger, and you invited me in. And I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Master, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?' The king replied, 'Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me.'" After he recited this, he looked toward the congregation and he told them all what he had experienced that morning. Throughout the entire congregation, all around, several, with heads bowed in shame, began to cry. He said, "Today I see a gathering of people, not a church of our Christ. The world has enough people, but not enough disciples. When will you decide to become his true disciples?" He then dismissed the service until next week. Do you see why it's important that we're always prepared to have a smile, to do a good deed, to care for someone, even if it seems uncomfortable? Oh, we have to do it carefully. We're being given a certain wisdom by Yahuwah to think things through. You don't just go up to any homeless person on the street who might be drug addicted, who might be harmful to you. You have to be smart. This world is full of wolves in sheep's clothing, but we cannot let that make us negative and treat everybody and every opportunity with a negative heart. But seek out goodness and do good, especially where you know it's good to do so. Now, doing good. Nobody in that auditorium, save three people, did good. It's important that we do good. I'll tell you a story about a pastor who was at a convenience store. It was a local pastor from the church there, And he went into the convenience store to get a few things. And he was here at this convenience store in, I believe it was New Orleans. And as he approached the counter, he saw a man and a woman and a child. And he could see they were absolutely destitute. They didn't look good physically. They didn't smell good. And they looked very down. They had grabbed a few things to eat and reached down in to pay for it and realized they didn't have enough money. So they were slowly trying to put away or put aside the food that they couldn't afford to buy. Well, this man tapped the man on the shoulder from behind him, this pastor. He said, "You don't need to turn around. Please accept this money." And the man, who was ashamed of having to take money from somebody else, took the money without ever seeing the preacher. See, these people were not your typical, they weren't homeless walking the street. They were down and out because they'd lost their home, they'd lost their jobs, they'd lost everything from the event there that occurred at that time, the flooding and so forth. And they had nowhere to go. All they had in the world was the car that they were sleeping in. So he took the money, this man, he was proud, but he took it. 9 years later now, this pastor was invited to speak at another church that was a neighboring church of his. This was some years later, as we said, 9 years, and after the service that he gave, a man walked up to him and said to the preacher who had shared this story, he began to share his story about his faith in Christ. He said, "You know, several years ago, my wife and my child, we were destitute. We had lost everything. We had no jobs. We had no money. We were living in our vehicle. We lost all hope. We couldn't get anybody to help us. I was too proud to be helped in some cases. My wife and I felt the only thing that was right to do would be for all of us to leave this earth. So we had this pact that we were going to commit suicide as a family." Well, as we looked at our child, and we hadn't eaten, we had no food, but we had just a little bit of money, we decided to go to the convenience store before we drove to where we were going to go and see if and give our son a last meal, something that he would like to eat. And so we went there to buy him some food and milk. And as we were standing in line, we realized that we did not have enough money to pay for these items. We thought we had enough, but we didn't. There was a man, until this day, I didn't know, who came behind us and asked us to take money from his hand and not look at him. This man said three words: "Christ loves you." When we left the store, we drove to our designated spot that we were going to die in. We wept there for hours. We couldn't go through with it. We drove away. And as we drove, we noticed that there was an assembly hall, a church, with a sign out front. It said, "Christ loves you." So we went to that church that very next day. My wife and I, we were saved. We came to know who our Savior was. He told the pastor, "When you began speaking this morning, I knew immediately that you were the man who gave us that money. Your act of kindness was much more than a simple deed. Three people are alive today because of it. Friends, do good. Hebrews 13:16, Abu Yahu. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to Yahuwah. Philippians 2:4. Let each of you not only look to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Luke 6:38. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap. For with the measure you use it, it will be measured back to you. 1 John 3:17, Yohanan. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does Yahuwah's love abide in him? Matithyahu, Matthew 25:35-40. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. And the righteous answered him, saying, Savior, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? Again, we realize that he's saying to you and me, to the least that you do it to another of my flock, my people, you do it to me. Who are his people? We don't always know, do we? We have to be willing to do good. And maybe what you do will help this one, if they're not his people, to become one of his people. Or maybe this one is one of his people, and you did something that saved their life. James 2:14-17. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also by faith itself, if it does not have works, it is dead. This is why you must not only seek for good, friends, and seek out the good, positive things, but that you must do good. Galatians 6:2. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the covenant of Yahuwah. Yahuchanan 15:12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Matithyahu 5:16. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Not by proclaiming how good you are, but that they may see your good works, friends. Proverbs 19:17. Whoever is generous to the poor lends to the Savior, and he will repay him for his deed. Proverbs 22:9, whoever has a bountiful eye will be blessed, for he shares his bread with the poor and unfortunate. Matithyahu 5:42, give to the one who begs from you. Do not refuse the one who would borrow from you. Now, these are all interpretations, and you'll get different things from different Bibles, different scriptures, but you understand what's being said. It's telling us that we're to care for the weak, care for those downtrodden, lift up as much as we can the poor of heart. Romania 15:1, we who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Because why? Friends, you're the salt of the world, of the earth, as Matithyahu, Matthew 5 says. You are the light of the world. And your light cannot be hidden because you're a vessel with Yahuwah's truth in you. And so you should not hold back your smiles, your goodness, and your love. Because when you give and let your light shine, you let your vessel shine, Yahuwah sees your good works. It glorifies Yahuwah. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. Says that in Yahuchan in 15:13. Abriyahu, Hebrews 6:10, for Yahuwah is not unjust, so as to overlook your work and the love that you have shown for his name in serving the saints, it says, but in any translation, just doing and taking care of and helping others. Matithyahu 10:8, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying, also you are to give without pay. Romans 12:13, contribute to the needs of others and show hospitality. 2 Corinthians 9:12, for the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but it's also overflowing in many thanksgivings to Yahuwah. So the needs of the family, the brothers and the sisters, we do our best. Now, many of us, recognizably, we don't have a lot to give financially. So we want to do what we can do. There's always things that we can do. And even if we have very little, we think about the widow's mite. She had nothing, and she gave what she had. We have to be careful, though. As I have found in my life, there are many, many who will seek to take advantage of your goodness. So be wise. Be wiser than serpents. Proverbs 3:27, do not withhold good from those whom it is due when it is in your power to do it. And Mark 10:21, and Yahuwah, looking at him, loved him and said to him, you lack one thing, go sell all that you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me. Ephesians 4:28, let the thief no longer steal. Let him labor. Do honest work with his own hand that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Our walk, friends, is about doing good for others. Helping others. We have to do more. I have to do more. You may feel that this is something that is toward you, but this is as much toward me as it is to you. That we must do good as Yahuwah's people. Acts or Messiah Malachi 20:35, in all things I have shown you, that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak. And remember the words of our Savior, how he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Luke 3:10, the crowds asked him, what then shall we do? He answered them, whoever has two tunics is to share with him who has none. Whoever has food is to do likewise. Romania 14:13. And friends, this is important. Romania is such an incredible book because it truly tells us and teaches us to not be a judgmental person in so much as we are to look for the positive things of our brothers and sisters. Time and time again, the theme is that we look at what they're doing. If they're Thanksgiving people, then they are doing Thanksgiving things to Yahuwah. And who are you or I to judge them in their Thanksgiving to Yahuwah? How they do it, what they do. This is something that many who claim to know Yahuwah, many who profess and like to keep a lot of different types of traditions and things, that's fine. But they will tend to use that as a stumbling block for hindrance of others and say, you're not doing it this way, on this date, at this time, in this way. And that's why Romania tells us that if whatever you do, a brother does it in Thanksgiving, that this is enough, that he is a brother. That means put away your judgment. In Romania, it says, therefore, let not pass judgment on one another any longer, but rather decide never to put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of a brother. I know and am persuaded in our Savior Yahuwah, that nothing is unclean in itself, but it is unclean for anyone who thinks it's unclean. For if your brother is grieved by what you eat, you're no longer walking in love. But what you eat, do not destroy the one for whom our Savior died. So do not let what you regard as good be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of Yahuwah is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, of peace, and joy in the set-apart spirit of Yahuwah. Makes it very clear, does it not? So we can go on and on here, but all these scriptures, and I've got a list of hundreds of them here that talk about love one another, have brotherly affection, outdo one another in showing honor, it says in Romania 12:10. It says in Matithyahu 20:26, it shall not be so among you, but whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Time and time again, over and over and over, in the Old Testament as it's referred to, or the New Testament, it says that we must do these things. Do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourself. Who am I? Absolutely nothing. But my brother and my sister is everything to me. This has got to be our attitude. Who is your brother or your sister? See, our Savior declared that. You know, who is my mother, my brother, my sister? It's all those who seek to keep the word of Yahuwah, the covenant of Yahuwah. And it's our job to love one another, especially covenant keepers, not be judgmental towards each other. Are you keeping covenant? Are you keeping the name of Yahuwah? This is enough. And Yahuwah will lead you as he deems fit. Not me. Who am I? Who do I think I am? I'm nothing. Praise Yahuwah, you are my brother. You are my sister, and I praise Yahuwah for you. You are greater than me. Now let us worship and praise Yahuwah eternally. And this is what our Savior taught, because it's love, because it's mercy. Kazu Yahu, the book of the Revelation of Yahuwah. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and eat with him, and he with me. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and eat with him, and he with me. The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Ruach Spirit is saying to the people of Yahuwah. So who are we to judge? Who's a lover of Yahuwah? Keeping covenant and his name set apart. It's a very simple formula, is it not? These are the people who knock at his door, and we will not judge them. So, be courageous, as Deuteronomy says, do not fear or be in dread of time, for it is Yahuwah, your Almighty, who goes with you. He will not leave you, nor will he forsake you. And do not grow weary of doing good, in Galatians 6:9, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. Now, something very interesting, brothers, sisters. And finally, in Abrayahu or Hebrews 13:1, and Abrayahu means family of Abraham in Yahuwah. Let brotherly love continue. This is in chapter 13, verse 1 to 6. Do not forget to show hospitality to foreigners, for in doing so, some have entertained Malachia, or messengers, or angels of Yahuwah, without even knowing it. My friends, we need to bow our own heads in shame as we look back in our life on the times we could have and should have helped others and did not. And as we do so, realize that we may have been tested by a very angel of Yahuwah without even knowing it, and we did not do good. Be careful who you cut off in your car, how you drive. Be careful how you treat others when you go places. Be careful, because you will never know. And our Savior, that's why he said, you clothed me, you did this, you did that. And those who felt that they were set apart said, when did we ever see you needing clothing or need to support you in any way? Because of all these ones that needed you, that you did not help, you also did not help me. Further, it says, remember those who are in prisons, as though bound with them, and those who are ill-treated, since you are also part of their bodies. Let marriage be held in honor among all. Let the bed be undefiled. But Almighty loving Yah of all creation will judge the immoral and the adulterers. Be free from the love of money. Content with such things as you have. Content with such things as you have. And these preachers on first day always talking about how you, God wants you to have this and to have that, and you can have everything. And I mean, some of these guys like Joel Osteen, and I mean, they're like the Anthony Robbins of motivational speakers for quote-unquote God. You know, be content with the things that you have. Be free from the love of money. And you can help others. If money's just a tool, then you love to help others. If your neighbor asks to borrow your hammer, you don't have a problem lending him your hammer. It's a hammer. Use it. It's to be used. Money's a tool. It's to be used. I have some. I have extra. If you need it, I can give you some. Do not be afraid, nor be scared of them. For I, Yahuwah, Almighty loving Yah of all creation, freeing his people, goes with you. He will not fail you nor forsake you. So that with good courage we can say, Yahuwah is always with me. I will not be afraid. What can Adam, or rather Adam, that is unbelieving man, do to me? See, that's also reiterated in Tehillim or Psalms 118:6 and 118:7. And so, friends, I hope that this lifts you up today in doing good. Not just seeking out for good, but doing good and understanding that you're paying forward goodness. You're letting others see your good works, because this is the culmination or the total of all that you're doing for Yahuwah, for others to see, and then also themselves do the same thing. So look for good and do good. Well, certainly Daniel, if there was anyone in scriptures who was known as doing good or being good, other than our Savior who was perfectly good, Daniel was one of those people who did good. He was courageous. He would take the time to help others and to declare the truth, even in the face of danger. You know, Daniel was one of two people in Scripture who were referred to as beloved. In fact, Daniel was referred to as beloved twice. And this was by Yahuwah's messengers. In one case, an archangel. Can you imagine? Beloved Daniel. Can you imagine being referred to by one of Yahuwah's archangels as beloved? Well, we know of three archangels. We know of the angel Gabriel. The angel Gabriel was certainly an incredible archangel. All his feats in Scripture stand out to us. We also know of the archangel Michael. And Michael was a little different from Gabriel. Gabriel was known as being sort of the announcer, the one who would announce things. He was given information to declare to people, whereas Michael was a warrior. This was one bad dude in the good sense. He had the whole armor of Yahuwah. He was strong. He came in and he took care of business. And even to this day, he comes in and he takes care of business. And in the future, he's going to also be there to do just the same thing. The third archangel that's referred to by name, it was actually Lucifer. He was one of those seven archangels who, he was one that fell, though, did he not? He did some bad stuff and lost his position as an archangel of Yahuwah. But Daniel, being a fleshly, earthly man, a sinful man, was known as being beloved and was spoken of by Yahuwah's archangel as being beloved. So when we reflect upon what Daniel has written in the word of Daniel, it adds more seriousness to it, in that we realize how good he was, how proper it is that we should study this word, because he did everything just so for Yahuwah. Much of what is in the book of Daniel correlates with, works with, the book of Revelation by Yahuwah. The Revelation book cross-references much of what's in here. Daniel 7 specifically is a chapter that, if you do not understand some of the basic elements of what's being described, it's hard to know what's really being said. So let's begin, and as we read from the book of Daniel chapter 7, I'm going to stop We're going to talk about a few things this morning, and it's the understanding that we have as far as the meaning of certain things to help us realize this dream or vision that Daniel had. Daniel chapter 7, verse 1. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream, and he had visions of his head on his bed. And he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Interesting that he wrote the dream down, isn't it? Now, he knew that he was a vessel for Yahuwah, and he did not despise these dreams. They did trouble him from time to time, but he knew that they were important, and he wrote them down. Praise Yahuwah that he did so. Daniel, the book of, we would not have today had he not done that. And also, Daniel was referred to by our master as well as a prophet. So we have a second witness to this incredible book, which is truly a second witness to the prophecies here, and the importance, therefore, is even greater in learning what's being said and understanding it. Daniel spoke and said, I saw in my vision by night, and hear this, the four winds of the sky broke forth on the great sea. Four great animals came up from the sea, diverse from one another. Okay, so these first two scriptures, we're looking at animals. There's a lot of animals used here in these visions and so forth. A lot of symbolization. The lion with the wings of an eagle and then it says its wings were plucked off and it stood on two feet and it was given a human mind. These were elements here, but it's a but before we even get to that, the area here that we've read in verse 2 and 3, these were symbols for wickedness in referencing Revelation chapter 13. Now, we also have to understand that this is referring to Babylon. You see, the Babylon in verse 4, notice here it says, the first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I saw until the wings of it were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made to stand on two feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. Well, the wings torn off here, they really represented Nebuchadnezzar's insanity, while the lion was being given a human mind representing his restoration. See, Nebuchadnezzar, we spoke of in the previous, about how he fell, about how he was proud, about how he had to be brought down because of his pride. But that after that seven-year period of being like an animal, that Yahuwah, after having his wings torn off, Yahuwah made him a lion. He made him whole again. His repentance restored who he was, and not only that, he magnified and glorified Yahuwah. He became friends with Daniel. Daniel cared for Nebuchadnezzar. And so there was a relationship for a long period of time between Nebuchadnezzar and Daniel all the way to his death. But he received this restoration, and that's what's represented here in verse 4. It's important to understand that. It's important to know that Babylon is not only when Nebuchadnezzar was prideful, but it's also prideful Babylon after Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar was a man who separated himself as far as his blessings, as far as his teachings, his understandings, as far as how he was as one of Yahuwah's people now, that he lifted Yahuwah up. He was separate really from Babylon. He was still part of it until his death. But He was not Babylon itself. So even to this day, Babylon is a prideful bird, an eagle. But that even to this day, this may have a prophecy repeating in itself of the eagle's wings being plucked off. We look at here in the United States, the eagle representing the greatness of the country that is the United States. But how, friends, make no mistake that the pride of this country, and unless there's repentance and a turning back to the covenant of Yahuwah, can also too have its wings torn off. We see the possibility of that because things are not going very well for this country. But yet there's still hope, just as it was hope for King Nebuchadnezzar. And we pray for that. That's been kind of a theme here through Daniel as we've been talking about how it's important to understand that Yahuwah puts in power who he will. Doesn't mean that he is the creator of Babylon the Great. We know that Shaitan, that these are his kingdoms. But Yahuwah is great. Yahuwah is the Most High. Nothing happens without him being in control. Even if Shaitan thinks he's in control with the kingdoms of the world, he has no clue. That's the pride of Shaitan. He thinks he's as sharp as Yahuwah. Are you kidding? You only think you are. Man, in the same way, thinks he's as smart as, or smarter than, or better than, to is not even believe that there is a creator, that there is a Most High Father. And so we put all this together from just these first few verses. And this understanding is important because it's prophecy. It's prophecy not only then, but it's prophecy now. Things in Scripture repeat themselves. We've heard the term that history repeats itself. The symbolizations are important. The understandings are important. So further now in verse 5, hear this, another animal, a second, like a bear, and it was raised up on one side, and three ribs were in its mouth between its teeth, and they said thus to it, arise, devour much flesh. Well, we believe that at that time, Medo-Persia being represented here. But even with that which was done then, we believe that the three ribs are between the teeth of this bear and are being devoured. The flesh being devoured represents death. Three, back then, there were major conflicts at that time. We won't go into it this time, but in our modern era, now, we believe, or I believe, that this depicts military wars, World War I, World War II, and World War III. And the bear, possibly Russia. But regardless, and there's a lot of different interpretations, there's war. There's the loss of life, if you will, or the devouring of flesh. Verse 6, after this I saw and hear this, another like a leopard, which had on its back four wings of a bird. The animal had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. Now this, quite possibly Greece, a leopard-like creature, four wings, four heads, dominion, the four heads representing the four kingdoms of that time that were led by Alexander's four generals when he died back in 323. And this was all part of that was going on after the time of Daniel. All prophecy. Verse 7, and this I saw in the night visions, and hear this, a fourth animal, awesome and powerful and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and broke into pieces and stamped the residue with its feet. And it was diverse from all the animals that were before it, and it had 10 horns. I considered the horns, and hear this, there came up among them another horn, a little one, before which 3 of the first horns were plucked up by the roots. And hear this, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. This is Rome. A powerful beast with iron teeth and 10 horns. The 10 horns, friends, represent the kingdoms that would arise out of the old Roman Empire. Still affecting us to this very day. It's very prophetic. In verse 9, I saw until thrones were placed, and one who was ancient of Yaum sat. His clothing is white as sand, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames, and the wheels of it burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from him. Thousands of thousands ministered to him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. Now, verse 11, I saw at the time because of the voice of the great words which the horns spoke. I saw even until the animal was slain and its body destroyed, and it was given to only be purified by the discipline of the word. As for the rest of the animals, their dominion was taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a year and a time. And I saw in the night visions, and hear this, there came with me the clouds of the sky, one like a son of Adam. And he came even to the ancient of Yaoms, and they brought him near before him. There was given him dominion and magnificence and a kingdom that all the peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. Now, we recognize in verse 7 to 8, the Rome being the beast with the iron teeth and the 10 horns, and that those represented the old, this kingdomhood that would arise out of the old Roman Empire. We see it to this day. And a little horn, the one talked about here with the eyes, human eyes and blasphemous mouth, pluck out 3 horns from the fourth beast. That is the Antichrist. Plucked up by the roots. The man speaking great things. This would be the Antichrist that would defeat the 3 of the 10 kingdoms and dominate them all. Those 10 kingdoms that arose out of the Roman Empire. Now you look at the Ancient of Days. You look at what's known as what we believe to be Yahuwah. Yahuwah the Father being declared. Verse 9. Ancient of Yaoms sat with his clothing as white and his hair like pure wool, etc. This Yahuwah giving his dominion to his son, Yahu. This is spoken of. It talks about a son in verse 13, like a son of Adam. That is his son Yahuwah. See, this book of Daniel, which was centuries before our Savior came, prophesied of our Savior's coming in this verse here. Spoke of the Antichrist, then the Father, and then the Son. That he would come even to the Ancient of Days, or Yaoms. That he was given dominion and magnificence, that all the kingdoms and the peoples and the nations would serve him. Dominion was his everlasting from this point, which shall not pass away. His kingdoms, it shall not be destroyed. This is the Savior, the Messiah, receiving dominion. Now, this is how we know that our Savior did not have dominion prior to this, friends. For those that would say God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit are one, they always were, they always will be. Friends, this specifically clears up in our minds that Yahuwah is the Ancient of Yaoms, the prior that ever was, that his son was given something. You can't be given something if you already had it. No, friends, he was given dominion and magnificence. For if he was already combined with his father and was one with his father in literal, then he would not be needed to be given anything, because it was his father's to give him and him alone. And so he was given dominion over the world to defeat the Antichrist, to defeat Shaitan. This is what's most important for you to understand in this chapter 7. Yes, there's a lot of animals. Yes, there's a lot of understandings about what they represent. But know that our Savior is prophesied to come, and he did. And he's prophesied to defeat the Antichrist, and he will. This prophecy has partly been proven to be at the time of our Savior, and will fulfill fully at the time of the destruction of the Antichrist that we think is about and upon us, if not immediately now, very soon. Further, it says in 15, as for me, Daniel, my spirit, my ruach, was grieved in the middle of my body. In the visions of my head, they troubled me. And I came near to one of those who stood by and asked him the truth concerning all of this. So he told me and made me know the interpretation of the things. These great animals which are four are four kings who shall arise out of the earth. But the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. Interesting. As we know that when our Savior comes, there's going to be 12 over the 12,000, totaling 144,000, who prior to this slaying of the beast, the serpent, the Antichrist, prior to this, our Savior will take a few, not all Christians, not all religions, not all peoples. It's not, you're not going to be taken out and just, you get to be free and saved immediately without going through Armageddon. Because Armageddon talks about different levels of his people going through different things. There's going to be a group, a final group, a set apart, a very small number left of that 144,000 who will be taken up, as in Thessalonica talks about that ascension. There's no rapture of millions of people. It's not going to happen, because millions of people do not know the name of Yahuwah. Millions of people do not keep his covenant fully, millions of people do not also to have the love of Yahuwah within their hearts. There's very, very few set apart enough to be part of the 144,000 remainder that's still on this earth. However, there will be many who will slowly over time come to all the different understandings and the importance of covenant and love and treatment of others and goodness in their hearts and fruitages within their hearts and an understanding of Scripture as they're meant to have. And as this happens, wherever you and I are, we don't know, are we going to be part of the bride? Are we going to be part of those who are attending the wedding? Are we going to be those who are going to have to learn the hard way about several things? Wherever we fall, we know that there's a role to play for all of us. So, it says that the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever and ever. Then I desired to know the truth concerning the fourth animal, which was diverse from all of them, exceedingly terrible, whose teeth were of iron, and its nails of brass, which devoured, broke in pieces, and stamped the residue with its feet. And concerning the 10 horns that were on its head, and the other horn, which came up and before which three fell, even that horn that had eyes and a mouth that spoke great things, whose look was more strong than its fellows. I saw, and the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them, until the Ancient of Yaoms came, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, and the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. So there's a lot of activity going on with Yahuwah's people at all levels. I saw the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them. You see, it's not a happily ever after. There are things that Yahuwah's people will be going through until Yahuwah and his son provide what is necessary for us to obtain and possess and be with him in that kingdom forever. Thus he said, the fourth animal shall be a fourth kingdom on earth, which shall be diverse from all the kingdoms and shall devour the whole earth and shall tread it down and break it in pieces. As for the 10 horns, out of this kingdom shall 10 kings arise, and another shall arise after them. And he shall be diverse from the former, and he shall put down three kings. So see, this talks about at the time of our Savior, from that moment, and especially through the Dark Ages, as we know it in history, all the way down to this very day, Yahuwah's people, his true people, not everyone, there's a lot of good people, and they still have much to learn, and they've gone through their life body, and they're now resting and awaiting the resurrection so that they can come to Yahuwah, repent from their lack of knowledge, from their sin as well, and grasp, hold on to, appreciate, and declare his great name, his great word, and make their minds over in his way. But these ones are separate from those who seek earnestly through the centuries and were given Yahuwah's true name, were given the true understandings, those 144,000. Down to this very day, there would be some alive who will be caught up with him upon his coming. Just a few. Will we be there? Boy, I hope so. But, however, if we're not, we will stand firm, just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. For they said, if Yahuwah takes us out of this fire, great. And if he doesn't, we will still stand firm for Yahuwah. His will be done. And that's how we as Yahuwah's people feel right now. We may not be set apart enough for the privilege of that position, which is really a servant position anyway. However, if we are not, we will stand firm like Shadrach. We will keep our faith. These 10 horns that arose the 10 kingdoms shall then 10 kings arise in verse 24. And they did, and they have. And another shall arise after them, and he shall be diverse from the former, and he shall put down three kings. And so this Antichrist that is coming, which is going to defeat these three of the ten kingdoms and dominate them. That's going to happen, and that's about to happen. We're very close to this. Everything points to it. But we have an incredible, joyful lifting up that occurs when we read these words, because we know that it is purposed, that Yahuwah, all things are in his hands. And we're just here for the ride and to help others and to do our best and to say, praise Yahuwah. And we're on board, Master. We're on board, Father, in whatever capacity. As servants, we do whatever it takes. We'll serve food. We'll clean the toilets. We'll do whatever it is that Yahuwah wants us to do. But the judgment shall be set. Because further it says, after he puts down the three kings in verse 24, he shall speak words against the Most High. You see, he's going to come against Yahuwah. We're being warned of that. He's not going to come against the pagan names of the world, the Hovas and the Zeuses. He's going to come against the Most High, Yahuwah. And he'll wear out the saints, it says, of the Most High. He shall think to change the times. And the word, he has already. He'll do it even more. They shall be given into his hand until a time and times and half a time. So again, it goes back, it goes forth, back and forth. 3,500 years, time, times, and half a time. What is that? A time, 1,000 years. Times, 2,000 years. That's a total of 3,000. And half a time is half of 1,000, 3,500 years. So we estimate a 7,000 years in the time frame and understanding of Yahuwah's word. Was there anything before that? Well, science has its feelings about certain things. There's a lot of different understandings. All we know is Yahuwah's people definitively, that we're to understand what's going on now in this 7,000 term. Zero was the year of our Savior when he was born. 3,500 years before that was from Adam and his wife, Chua, known as Eve, Adam and Eve. That's 3,500 years from the time of our Savior's birth to now. This is what? This is the year 2013. That means that there's another 1,000 plus 500 years after now. And of that 1,500 years, there'll be a time in that period of 1,500 years where Shaitan will be 1,000 years in his darkness, placed there when our Savior comes. Towards the latter part of this 1,500 years, but yet possibly starting in this last generation, we pray. We don't know, but we look at the signs and we look at things changing. So that 1,500 years doesn't mean we have 500 years to wait for our Savior. We will not know the day or the hour. We'll just know the season. We believe we're in this season. So there'll be a time after Shaitan is in that 1,000 years. Well, he'll be let out. Will it be 100 years? Will it be 200 years? Will it be 300 years? Will it be 400 years? Will it be 450 years before he's fully destroyed or more? Well, we know that there's roughly 1,500 years left now in this time, times and half a time, or 3,500 years since the time of our Savior. 2013 plus 7 years ago, we believe. And so there's a lot that's going to happen. There's a lot that is happening. And judgment, it says in verse 26, shall be set, and they shall take away his dominion to destroy, and to destroy it to the end. You see, take away his dominion. The kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole sky shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. And so we know that Shaitan's going to be having taken away his dominion. He's going to be abyssed. And Yahuwah's people are going to rise up. And there's going to be much that's going to happen, as we can see in the book of Revelation. And it's very troubling for Daniel, because it's amazing to see what is going to happen. It's like nothing that's ever happened before. Verse 28, here is the end of the matter. As for me, Daniel, my thoughts much troubled me, and my face was changed in me, but I kept the matter in my heart. And he did. But he also wrote it down. And fortunately, we have the book of Daniel. We have the ability now to make clear in our minds the things that have happened then, the things that have happened in recent centuries, and the things that are happening right now, and the things that are going to happen after. And praise Yahuwah for his understanding and his love, his ability to make clear to us what is happening and what's going to happen. So as we praise Yahuwah today on Shabbat, thank him for this understanding and the understandings that are to come, the prophecies that are still to come, that we do not despise prophecy, that we have our hearts and minds open even to the ability to receive dreams and visions. Daniel was beloved. This is why he received his abilities to do what he did. Just as Moshe and just as Abraham were, in one case, a friend of Yahuwah, but faithful to Yahuwah, beloved by Yahuwah, may we seek to do good. May we seek out good, so that we also too can be beloved by Yahuwah, be a friend to Yahuwah. It's time that we make our minds over, that we receive him. Do you receive him today, friends? I know that you receive him because you are here listening to his word, and you are truly the lovers of Yahuwah that will inherit this kingdom that is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions that serve and obey Yahuwah. You are a part of that. Declare it this day in the almighty loving name that is Yahuwah.